Hello, everyone. This is James Lawrence, and I have given you a few teachings over the past few weeks, if it's even been that long. But I've been talking about things such as the Antichrist coming, and also about the false prophet who is the sidekick of the Antichrist, who causes these signs and wonders to happen in front of people on behalf of the beast. That's another name for the Antichrist. And it makes people wonder and think, what a great man this beast is. He even has a prophet that follows after him and does things on his behalf. And they will be, some will be very much deceived by this, and they'll think that the beast is like Christ. They'll think, you know, Antichrist not only means against Christ, it's also a word that means instead of. So he is a counterfeit, of course, Christ. He's a counterfeit Christ, and he's going to fool some people into following him because of the great things they see happening. And then I did talk about also the three sets of seven judgments in some other videos, and that was the seven seal judgments, the seven seals opened by Jesus himself. And then the seven trumpets that are blown by mighty angels in heaven. And then the seven bowls that are poured out. And these judgments, if you'll go back and watch those, they get progressively worse. They are extremely bad. They're almost, we can say this, I guess, but it's almost unbelievable to think that this many horrid, terrible things could happen. But they are the righteous indignation of God. We can't speak against them and say, why doesn't God not allow these to happen? Well, he is actually causing them to happen. And then Satan will be loose doing through the Antichrist, doing his many things that will deceive the world because there will be yet more time for them to receive Jesus Christ during what's called the Great Tribulation period. Now, some people say, oh no, salvation is cut off by that time. Well, this is not what the Bible says. It talks about spirits in heaven, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And they apparently have some type of, they are asking God, when will you avenge us? And it says, those that were beheaded for Christ, who are martyrs. That means they died for their faith in Jesus. And so that's very interesting, and they are given a special garment because they died for the Lord and had their testimony. And so people will be saved during this time. And so God does certain things to try to get the people who were left behind, to become born-again believers in Jesus Christ, simply meaning born-again means new birth in your spirit, because the Bible says when you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that all things pass away within your spirit, and behold, all things become new. And it's not a matter of emotions or anything like that. It is simply a fact. If you receive Jesus Christ, as it says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. The Bible says that God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So there's a couple of scriptures that kind of knock away idea that certain people have in the world today of Christendom, and I just say the world of Christianity, but they think that people are selected to be saved by the Lord, and some people are selected, literally, are selected for hell, eternal hell, and there's nothing they can do to be saved. The other people, they will eventually have an irresistible grace in which they must be saved, but that goes against the free will that is so clearly shown in the scriptures that it's not even funny. And yet they go against that and say, oh no, there's no free will. You are forced into salvation, or you're forced to not want to receive Jesus Christ. There's no choice, but the Bible says there is a choice, and it says it so many times. It's incredible that there are people who still believe that that's not the case. So please know Jesus died for you on a cross, shedding his blood for the remission of your sins so that you could be forgiven of your sins. And afterward, he died on that cross, was placed in a tomb, but raised from the dead 3 days later. Okay, so Jesus is a wonderful, just fabulous, fantastic Savior. We don't deserve any of this, folks. We don't deserve a single iota, as the word goes. We don't deserve the dot of an I of anything from God. But because of his own free grace, his call to salvation also, and his free grace, which means unmerited favor, we can receive him and be born again, as I mentioned earlier, in our spirits. It's also called being saved and becoming a new creature in Christ. And it's called becoming a Christian, because in the scriptures, it says in the book of Acts that they were first called Christians in Antioch. Okay, so it's really a term that does mean that you're a disciple of Jesus. You have become like him because you've received him into your heart, which happens through the Holy Ghost. I've heard people say, Jesus didn't come and abide in your heart. Well, then why did Jesus himself say, I will return to you? He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Okay, his presence is real within us through the power of the Holy Ghost. Something that is hard, really, to understand, but that's it. It says the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. So we have the gifts of the Spirit, and we're more and more like Jesus. That's the whole point of it. And that's why the Holy Spirit comes and helps us to become more and more like Jesus by walking in the fruits of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering. You know, oh goodness, I used to could name those so easily. But anyway, all good personality traits that actually have a love within them. And it's supernatural, literally. Somebody say, it's not supernatural. It's just God helping us to be like that. God's helping you to be like that, but it's not supernatural. Okay. And there's also the gifts of the Spirit that I do believe are for today. These same people that believe salvation has to be decided by God and not a choice that you make to receive Jesus also often believe in something called cessationism, the ceasing of all the gifts of the Spirit that are listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And that are expounded upon by Paul all the way through to chapter 14. And I believe he even does that in 2 Corinthians. He talks about them to some degree. And in other epistles he wrote, he does as well. So let me talk about these guys that are coming, these men of God, great and mighty men of God, that are coming during the Great Tribulation period. And they are two witnesses, the Bible calls them, that will actually preach the gospel. Now, why would the gospel be preached if it wasn't for the very sake of people receiving it? Just because? No. Okay, let me read this. It's a chapter 11 in Revelation, verses 3 through 12. Now, it's strange, but this is how the Word of God does at times, because there's some things that are withheld from our knowledge. But it just drops in about these two witnesses. It says, and I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. Now this was a Jewish tradition of the clothed in sackcloth, meant it was a very serious time. Something very serious was being done in ministry. Okay, so clothed in sackcloth. These are the two, pardon me. These are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before the God of the earth. God Jehovah, our Father in heaven. And if any man will hurt them, these two witnesses, fire proceedeth out of their mouth and devoureth their enemies. Wow. And if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed. These have power to shut heaven that it rain not in the days of their prophesying, in the days of their prophecy, and have power over waters to turn them to blood, and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will. And when they shall have finished their testimony, the beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them and shall overcome them and kill them. Okay. The beast that ascends out of the bottomless pit. Now, I know there's probably interpretational controversy on this one. I'm reading from my Bible, by the way. But I do copy scriptures otherwise that are absolutely King James, exactly as they are in the Bible. But it says, this beast that ascends out of the pit shall make war with them and shall overcome them and kill them. Now, that's not a sad story all the way through. Give it a second here and I'll tell you. This beast, is it the Antichrist? Is it Satan himself? We're not really sure, although I would assume it's Satan. Okay, now verse 8. And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom in Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. And they of the people and kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and a half, and shall not suffer their dead bodies to be put in graves. And they shall dwell upon the earth, shall rejoice over them, over the death of these men that brought these plagues. Okay, this is what it's saying. And make merry, and shall send gifts one to another. Wow, what an occasion of celebration here. Because these two prophets tormented them that dwelt on the earth. And after 3 days and a half, the spirit of life from God entered into them, and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them. And they heard a great voice from heaven saying unto them, come up hither. And they ascended up to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies beheld them. Okay, afterward, it talks about a great earthquake that happens, and thousands of people are killed, and people are absolutely terrified about this, affrighted. And so they realized these guys were for real. They had some kind of purpose. And God the Father of heaven has raised them up and brought them up to heaven. You know, Jesus ascended to heaven the same way, with a cloud receiving him out of their sight. And he said, I will return the same way that I have left you. And an angel told them that while they stood there wondering, is Jesus just going to leave for a few moments and then come right back and bring something maybe from heaven to us? No, he ascended, but he said, I will return, and his second coming is yet to happen. But there's all these terrible things that I talked about, I didn't talk about in other videos, and but these two witnesses are just absolutely amazing, and they perform miracles and things. And this is going to happen during what's called the Great Tribulation period. Now, many great judgments will fall. I talked about the 21 different judgments, you know, the bowls, the trumpets, and the seals, which I just named them backwards, but it doesn't matter. There's 21 judgments, seven of each of those. So it's remarkable. Such terrible things will happen. Will these prophets be some type of, possibly, now this is speculation, I'm going to tell you that now, will they be some type of point of contact for some of these plagues that are mentioned, that these angels release through the trumpets and the seals, and or Jesus releases the seals, but also the bowls that are poured out on the earth during the Great Tribulation period? I don't know that, but I'm just saying, could it be? Because many great terrible things happen, such as water being turned to blood and so forth. And that's going to happen with these different judgments. I don't know. They may have stuff like this happen all over again, most likely. And how do people see from every part of the world these two witnesses in the street and then they're raised from the dead? Impossible back then. And for thousands of years after, or a couple of thousand years afterward, not even possible when this was prophesied by John the Revelator on the Isle of Patmos when he was excommunicated to that island and he saw these absolutely fantastic visions of God that God gave him about what's going to happen. And it's going to happen, folks. It's really going to happen, all of it. Well, there's some people say, it's just hard to take in. It's hard to believe. Yeah, I know. You know, for even the best Christian, it's just hard to imagine that such things could happen, but they are going to, folks, period. Okay, and these two witnesses are coming also. So just remember these things about the Great Tribulation period and try definitely to be saved, if you're not already, before it's too late. It could be that something happens to you and you don't live, you know, as long as you thought you would. Or that the rapture, which is the resurrection of the Christians, will occur and you won't be in that number. You won't rise up with them to heaven. And if that happens, you will be here during all these terrible things that happen. Now, that's not a scare tactic. It's just a fact from the Word of God. Okay, thank you so very much for listening to me. I wanted to make this under 20 minutes. The videos load faster when I do that, so that's what I'm going to do. Thank you for hearing me. God bless you. This is James Lawrence saying goodbye for now.